get our number. The world's in slumber, let's misbehave. There's something wild about you, child, that's so contagious. Let's be outrageous, let's misbehave. When Adam won Eve's hand, he wouldn't stand for teasing. He didn't care about those apples out of season. They say the spring means just one thing to little lovebirds. We're not above birds, let's misbehave.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Erica, Ron's daughter, for the few of you that I haven't met. I just want to welcome you on behalf of our whole family, let you know how beautiful it feels to be here with you all, surrounded by love and joy at Dad's life. So thank you so much for joining us, for coming from so many different places and sharing your hearts with us today. Good afternoon, and welcome to the Mitchell Gallery and St. John's College. We are part of the Mitchell Gallery team. I'm Director Heidi Shaler, Art Educator Lucinda Edinburgh, and Exhibit Preparator Neil Falanga. We're pleased to welcome you here, and thank you, Erica. Thank you, Erica and Barb, for making us a part of this very special afternoon. Our dear Ron, our first introduction to Ron Markman came through the 2001 exhibition, Joseph Albers, Formulation, Articulation, when Mitchell Gallery Advisory Board member Ebby Malmgren suggested Ron as a speaker for one of our lectures for the Albers Show. Ron's relationship with the Mitchell Gallery evolved over the next 16 years through his membership support, along with his participation in the book club, seminars, poetry writing workshops, and two exhibitions, Heroes, Villains, and Mermaids, The Fantastic World of Ronald Markman in 2005, and one held this past spring, The Fantastic World of Ronald Markman, a mini retrospective. Ron doesn't fit into a tidy art history genre, and I don't think he really wanted to. His father was a salesman in the garment district in Manhattan and was often given tickets to Broadway shows for the whole family. Lights, action, big hair, and colorful costumes provided some of the earliest inspirations for Ron's work. He studied cartooning at the Art Students League as a teenager and had an early career as a cartoonist for 17 magazine. Ron created lots of cartoons at the kitchen table growing up. He talked about the splatters from whatever his mother was whipping up in a bowl or pan that would end up on his artwork. And he had a family that didn't mind that he wanted to become an artist. Most of you probably know, following his time in the U.S. Army, Ron attended Yale University as an undergraduate and graduate student through the GI Bill, where he studied with Joseph Albers. At that time, Ron was really enthusiastic about the Swiss painter Paul Klee, who was known for his experimentation with color. Albers, recognized as the modern father of color theory, knew Paul Klee from their Bauhaus days together, and Ron sought out Albers' help at Albers as he hoped to learn art in the direction of Klee's works. It didn't quite turn out that way, though, but no one can deny that Ron left Albers and Yale with a solid education in color theory. We didn't see any works from Ron's Yale days in our exhibitions here, but he said while he was studying with Albers that he was completely dedicated to learning everything he could from him. Ron did, however, produce some drawings that he sold to the Museum of Modern Art, unbeknownst to Albers. Ron said he got tired of being restricted to the traditional geometrical square or rectangular canvases, so he began to experiment by cutting his canvases or boards into the shape of the character or object. Mukfa, his fantasy world, had not yet been fully conceived, but with the cutouts, there were plenty of cartoons and doodles. It was Ron's Fulbright Fellowship to Italy in the early 1960s that might mark the turning point in his work. Inspired by centuries-old maps in Roman museums, he created his own world of Mukva, where he invited all who saw it to enter and enjoy. In the village of Frascati, Ron became fascinated with the three-breasted woman of Frascati, otherwise known as La Pupazza Frascatana. This is a hard cookie made of flour and honey that honors a wet nurse who produced both milk and wine. As many of you know, the figure played prominently in Ron's work throughout the years, both in Mukva and other pieces. Barb has put together a display of the Frascati woman over in a basket so you can experience her for yourselves. Now, Lucinda.
Ron's understanding of color and his clever use of classic literature and American culture were well married. His love of slapstick, overused phrases, and the funny papers all come together in a well-composed works that makes us look at our lives in a different way. He makes us laugh at ourselves, not in a mocking way or a sarcastic way that could be said about Andy Warhol, but rather with a light-hearted analysis about our everyday lives. Seen in his sculptural painting Communication that says, "I'll pencil you in," or "we've got to get together," and other common phrases we often use with so much ease and not always a lot of thought or sincere intention. The world of Mukva, complete with a full cast of characters, police force, art dealers, soldiers, crooks, mermaids, royalty, remember Queen Miriam and King Wendell, who's actually there in the middle of the line, and love triangles with storylines, but also shops and enterprises vital to any metropolis, such as video and magazine racks, tourist attractions, public transportations with buses, airlines, and roadways, and all things that allowed us to be tourists without ever leaving the country. His use of common craft items, such as pom-poms, buttons, artificial flowers, fake jewels, glitter, and wood thingamajigs, integrated with his sculptural paintings on tin, and unlike the assemblages of his contemporaries, Robert Rauschenberg, Jasper Johns, Red Grooms, or Louise Nevelson. For one thing, their works didn't have Ron's wit. Working with Ron on the exhibitions has its own set of stories that we in the gallery continue to laugh about. As with any worthwhile effort, an exhibition has a range of worries and frustrations, but also many laughs, relief for things that work, and at the end of it, the overall exhilaration that occurs once everything is installed. There is no doubt in our minds that those who assisted with the Mukva Gate, the installation teams here in the Mitchell Gallery, the folks at Bonsai Fine Arts, Dick Malgram, who is essential in the gate's construction, and George Doskow, an able assistant, helped all felt this range of emotions. This doesn't include the planning, execution, and assembly at home, and how to get each piece in and out of the doors. Barb and Ebby were supportive as Dick and Ron made multiple trips to the hardware stores, tolerated the noise of power tools and hand tools, grinding, sawing, pounding, bumping, and squeaking as these things came together. Seeing the light in Ron's bright blue eyes as we also pounded and drilled things into place with the gate or wall pieces was a joy to us as we cheered his accomplishment. Even with his humor, there was a serious business side to Ron, too. He understood and appreciated the importance of having his work in major collections. He had sellout shows at Terry Ditton Fast Gallery in New York City, and his work is included at the Museum of Modern Art, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the Hirshhorn, the Library of Congress, and other institutions. It was great fun for us to sit in our office and hear visitors laugh and talk with each other as they looked at Ron's work. We were privileged to have shared and collaborated with Ron, especially over this past year. As Heidi said in Ron's New York Times obituary, he was a genius. He had limitless imagination. The viewer response was one of joy, one of humor, one of amusement. That any one artist could create this body of work, I don't think his mind ever turned off. Ron has probably continued to create more Mukva characters and scenarios since he has moved on to new circumstances. So adapting a phrase from the Marx Brothers movie Duck Soup for the fictional Fredonia, "Hail, hail, Fredonia," I'd say, "Hail, hail, Mukva." Having us all gathered here today in his honor renews the shared joy he had in our lives.
So Eric and I had only known each other a couple of weeks before I told her I wanted to meet her parents. And she was a little taken aback at the time. I don't think she had decided yet whether I was a keeper. But I was all in, so I wanted to meet her mom and dad. So when Ron and Barbara Markman came to Manhattan the next week, the four of us met up at the old Doubleday bookstore on Fifth Avenue and 56th Street. And then we ran around the corner to Ron's, to the Dint Fast Gallery, where they were hanging Ron's show that was opening. And then we walked around to the Carnegie Deli on 7th Avenue for lunch, which was Ron's favorite deli. And we ended the day at TKTS in Times Square to see if they had any half-price tickets for Sunday in the Park with George. So during my first afternoon with Ron, it really turned into a speed date of all of his favorite things. Books, painting, pastrami, Broadway, Barbara, and of course Erica. So I was 28 at the time, and I was still struggling to find my way as a writer and photographer in the big city, and I was sort of short on role models. In my family, the men and many of the women were doctors and lawyers. Ron was really the first painter I ever met, the first person, adult who had ever built his life around his art. And he was also the first adult I ever met who wore blue jeans to work. I had my Uncle Ed, who was considered the black sheep in the family, was an accountant who used to change into blue jeans at night and on weekends, but never to work. So, you know, as a film student, I'd recently gone to film school and I'd seen all the biopics about painters, and I knew they were tortured souls who hung out in brothels and had fights in bars and drank absinthe and sliced off their ears. And Ron wasn't like that. Ron didn't drink much, never in bars. He didn't get into fist fights. He didn't have torrid affairs with his models. And his very distinctive ears were featured prominently and very proudly in his paintings and drawings. So what Ron did was he rose early and sober every morning and began to paint his corner of the universe, which was keenly observed through somewhat kaleidoscope eyes. I think his world was equal parts, he saw it as equal parts tragedy and comedy, the Fufeng Club alongside the horrible caves, with lots of flying buses, cars, and planes crisscrossing overhead. Men wore colorful clothes and big hats, except when they were naked, in which case they had hairy legs and chased, voluptuous, wavy-haired women. Red-headed mermaids were ubiquitous, either singing from the rocks or languidly smoking cigarettes. Ron was very well-read, but he never presumed to advise me on writing. But he was always very encouraging, and he never seemed concerned about whether I'd be able to support my family on a writer's income. Most of all, he taught me by example what a creative professional does every day. He sits down to work in the morning, and he stays there till lunch. And after lunch, he sits back down again and keeps working until dinner. At intervals, he puts his art on display for sale or for review, but the daily face-off with the blank canvas or the blank page is a very personal and private event, and no one else can tell you how to do it. Ron was always grateful for his imagination. He often said, "If I couldn't draw, I would have driven a bus." But he never fetishized the process of painting. It's what he did every day, regardless of where he found himself. If he was in Maine, he painted Pumpkin Lighthouse. If he was in Agra, he painted the Taj Mahal. Ron didn't make rigid distinctions between his art with a capital A and his natural urge to illuminate the borders of daily life. As you saw in the slideshow, having Ron as my father-in-law meant hand-decorated wedding invitations, bat mitzvah invitations, birth announcements, hand-drawn postcards and envelopes. Holiday gifts were playfully painted cutouts suitable for hanging on the door of your bedroom or office. Ron's imagination was really an inexhaustible wellspring that he returned to every day, and we were all the beneficiaries. I also appreciate that Ron didn't flinch from sharing with me the, you know, occasional challenging periods in his creative life. He confided to me that in the mid to late 70s, he didn't feel he was doing his best work, even though he was actively exhibiting and selling out shows. He felt lost in the horrible caves, he said. His solution was to keep painting until he found his way back out into daylight. When Ron was about my age now, not long after Erica and I were married, he went through a particularly dark period when he lost his beloved wife to cancer. Not long afterwards, his New York gallery closed, and when he retired from teaching at IU, he lost the studio where he'd been painting for 30 years. It was a bleak period for him, but Ron never used any of his losses as an excuse to stop creating or living. He soon found a new studio and kept on painting, eventually found a new partner to share his life with, and a new home here in Annapolis, close to family, and he found a new exhibition space here at the Mitchell Gallery. Ron produced some of his best work in his last two decades, I think, a fact that we 60-somethings find enormously inspirational and reassuring. And I don't think there could be a better place to remember him and celebrate him than here at the Mitchell Gallery, surrounded by people he loved. I'm so grateful to have had Ron in my life and in my family and my heart these past three decades. I've missed him a lot this summer, and it's hard to imagine the future without him. It's bound to be less colorful, less animated, and a lot less fun. But I'm grateful to have his art as a living reminder of his irrepressible and creative spirit.
Hi, everyone. My name is Julia.
And my name is Charlotte.
And we are granddaughters numbers two and three. For everyone that knew Gramps, they know how much his three granddaughters absolutely loved and adored him. Gramps was an incredible man, and while we might be biased, we think that being his granddaughter was the best relationship to have with him. Sleepovers with Gramps, and extra helpings of Rocky Road ice cream, lots of Marx Brothers and Shirley Temple movies, and staying up way past our parents' designated bedtime. Up in Maine, visits meant learning how to expertly scavenge for sea glass and learning how to become a master of gin rummy.
And almost as importantly, he let us wiggle his ears and arrange the wispy hairs on his head in whatever way we pleased.
Despite the sadness of today, we are comforted by what a rich life Gramps had and what rich relationships Gramps had with each of his granddaughters.
These are some of our favorite fortunes from the fortune cookie.
Wisdom is more than a tooth. Fast food will become faster. Fast food will become immediate cuisine. Fast food will overcome rapid transit.
If your glass is half full, remember you already drank the other half. Your daydreams will meet your nightmares. The person you see in the mirror is only a reflection. On the menu of life, appetizers taste better than entrees.
You'll never get out of this world alive. Money isn't everything, but it helps. The future looks good, but it's your past that keeps catching up with you.
Worldly pleasures are just temporary, but they sure feel good. Take the time to think about the time you take. If your cup runneth over, you need a new bra.
And these are some of our favorite lines from 101 Things to Do Before You Die. Go the distance. Play the fool. Belch and break wind.
Look before you leap. Make love. Rub it in.
Drink and be merry. Don't let the bed bugs bite. Kick ass.
Shut up and listen. Rest assured. Sweep everything under the rug.
Pass the peace pipe. Take the money and run. Have a change of heart.
Cut corners. Run amok. Live and let live.
Root for the home team. Don't wait until tomorrow. Take the road less traveled.
Wonder what it all means. Have an open mind. Whistle while you work.
Wake up and smell the coffee. Use up your wishes. Pay the price.
Live your wildest dreams. If the shoe fits, wear it. Walk on the wild side.
Wish upon a star. Don't sweat it. Stir things up.
Get a life.
Hi, I'm Tanya. I'm the first granddaughter, and I'm here to talk about my grandfather. A few months ago, one of my best friends died. He was also one of my only true soulmates. I haven't faced the challenge of having to put his legacy into words since seventh grade, when I had to write an essay about the person who inspires me the most, although my own love for him has only grown stronger since then. I have met a lot of intelligent and talented people in my life, and everyone here knows what a skilled painter my grandfather was and how he'd seen basically every movie from the 20th century worth seeing. But I don't think these were what made him such a memorable individual, because I've observed that most people who are that gifted have this very tangible fear that people will discover what they don't know. And I think, in fact, most of us sort of tremble at the discrepancy between our inner and outer lives. We're afraid that people won't accept us for what we don't know and that we're not good enough. And so to mitigate that fear, we put on airs. And my grandfather never did that, and lo and behold, people adored him for that, I think. He told me proudly about when he was on the tenure committee at Indiana University. A bunch of academics were talking about Gregor Mendel, the biologist, and he was like, "Who's Mendel?" And they loved that he didn't know who Mendel was. This other time in the summer of 2011, I was interning at NIH, and he did this really silly painting of me that I still remember super vividly. I was wearing a green smock and studying a glob of brain tissue with yellow and black stripes called the crazy lobe, and the caption read, "Speak not to me, I'm interning the brain." So instead of hiding the crazy things that happened in his head, like most of us do, he made art out of them, and people loved it. From the time I was a little girl, I was drawn to my grandfather like a magnet. We spent weekends in his studio. We listened to the soundtracks of Chicago and Damn Yankees and work on our independent art projects. And I would always burst into tears because I messed up all my drawings. And he'd calm me down and say I could just start over again. He also let me scrape the dried paint off his table, which I found really oddly satisfying. We, of course, spent hours at art museums together. He'd take me to orchestral concerts at the Kennedy Center, where I would run up to the front and save us seats because everyone else was above the age of 50. He was also such a loyal and supportive grandfather. He would come all the way to DC to see me speak three lines in a play when I was little. And I could tell him anything. You know, we had this somewhat of a disparity in ages, but I never felt that there was anything I couldn't joke with him about or even talk to him about sincerely. When you look at his art, and the wonderful world of Ronald Markman, it seems like this really crazy, fantastical place. But what I realized upon further reflecting on it is that it reflects this really interesting, clever truth about how we saw the most absurd parts of the world. and how our obsession with sex and consumerism is so cartoonish and silly, and he reflected that in his painting. Someone recently asked me how having him as a grandfather and artist changed the way I experienced and thought about art. And my short answer to that is that if you are a satirist, like he was, being an artist means observing the world in a very deep, critical, and serious way, but then making sure that you take none of it seriously. But the way he created and appreciated art also instilled within me a very important life lesson. See, he had a great deal of respect and admiration for all the iconic artists, the Dadaists and the Post-Impressionists and the Realists and all, but he admired all these artists without feeling some need to be any of them. He always reminded me whenever I drew or painted something, whether it was good or bad, that there was no one else in the world who could have done it. However much he admired someone or an artist or their work, he never lost sight of how important it was to be original as an artist. And the art he created came first and foremost from his need to create for the sake of creating and not for the need to impress. In his way, he was quite humble, but not inauthentically so. He was a good artist and he knew it. He took pride in his accomplishments, but at the same time never thought he deserved anything more than he had. And he never saw failures as an excuse to stop trying. He applied to Cooper Union 4 times, is that right? And he was accepted the last time. So the past summer, I was in Little Deer Isle, where I'd visited him almost every summer of my life in Maine. It was, of course, my first time there without him. And it was super weird not to wake up at 5:30 a.m. to some Puccini opera playing in his studio. The last few summers I spent with him, he was dealing with his progressively declining Parkinson's, and walking and speaking were hard for him. I'd already seen my other grandfather struggle with it. It's a difficult disease, and I could see the frustration Gramps faced when he couldn't drive and speak with the same ease and all those other things that the rest of us sort of take for granted. But he had this amazing sense of humor and ability to find light in grim situations. He never stopped being the goofy, caring, kind-hearted person I'd always known him to be, and he never stopped calling me every week to ask me what was happening in my life and remind me he loved me. I remember a conversation we had during our last summer together in Maine, when he's talking about the things that had become hard for him since his Parkinson's had gotten worse. But then he added that part of growing older was learning how to deal with sickness, and that looking back, he thought about all the wonderful people and things in his life and everyone he had loved, about the art show that he had in March of this year, which was coming up. And that thinking about everything that he had, he felt so happy and fulfilled. So regardless of how much I may miss him now, I smile when I remember that conversation. I know that I'll never meet another person quite like him. I know that many people here will probably agree that there was something irreplaceable about my grandfather. But getting to know someone that unique and amazing is such a tremendous gift. I wouldn't trade it for the world. And I smile knowing that in 20 years, his influence on me and my love for him will persevere, transcendent and ever present.
I'm Barbara Cabot. I was Ron's partner for 21 years. When I look at my life over the past 21 years with Ron, I realize that it's been a remarkable series of weird coincidences and quirky strokes of luck and funny intersections of two lives that just fell together. We lived within blocks of each other in a small college town for almost 30 years, and we never really crossed paths. We met, as so often happens, when mutual friends brought us together, when Ron was 5 years into widowhood, and I'd been widowed for two. For those clever and patient friends who thought we would like each other, who thought we should be together, it was as simple and as complicated as casually arranging for us to be seated next to one another in a lecture hall and letting the introductions begin. Oh, hello, how nice to see you. His friends were throwing a birthday party next week for him, he said. Would I like to come? Oh, well, of course. What a nice idea. Blah, 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 blah. Plaintive conversation, poignant conversation. And yet, we persisted. One day, after we'd gone out for a few times on what I reluctantly called dates, I happened to mention to Ron that somehow the cap for the gas tank of my car had disappeared, and I probably asked him where you might go to buy another one. Anyway, the next afternoon when I came home from campus, there was a crumpled up little brown paper bag tied to the screen door of my house, and in it was a bright, shiny new gas cap. I didn't realize it at the time, but that was so Ron. And of course, it made me laugh out loud. But then a little later, I said to myself, well, hey, this guy looks pretty serious. I should probably pay attention. And not long after that, my big black furry poodle, Murphy the Wonder Dog, who many of you knew, fell in love with Ron, and Ron loved Murphy back. And by that time, I loved both of them. So there we were, off and running. A family. After Ron died, Erica and I got a lot of thoughtful, kind letters of condolence, and I noticed that the one thing people mentioned most about Ron was his gentle, funny personality, the twinkling blue eyes, the quick laugh, the sense of humor that was often clever, sometimes irreverent, occasionally bawdy, and always, always filled with joy. To be honest, I always suspected that I'd wandered into his life at the happiest, most satisfying time. It had little to do with me. He already was in a really good place. He'd survived the jolt and sadness of widowhood, and he had an adorable baby granddaughter, to be followed eventually by two other adorable granddaughters. He had friends and fans and family who loved him a great deal. And now he'd retired from teaching, and he had time to do nothing but paint every hour of every day, which was what he had really always wanted to do. And it was a life that made him so, so happy. And then we moved to Annapolis, and in another amazing, miraculous stroke of luck, within weeks of moving here, he had found Richard Malmgren, retired doctor, carpenter extraordinaire, man for all seasons. Dick, he always said he could never thank you enough. But here's one more. Thank you. Dick and Ron had a very close relationship. Together, they concocted so many of those beautiful, huge, imaginative structures they made over all those years. And eventually, we made so many other friends in the college and in the community. And we felt like we were truly the world's luckiest couple. I have to speak for a moment about the Parkinson's disease that he was diagnosed with late in life, 8 years ago, about how brave and uncomplaining and just how basically cool he was about it. He continued all along to be the crazy man who did the crazy art, but at 82, he elected to have deep brain stimulation surgery to calm the tremors in his hands, which enabled him to paint and create practically all the way until he died last spring. In closing, I would like to answer a couple of Ron questions that people are always asking me. Question number one, hey, what's the deal about those three-breasted women? What's up with that? Well, you've heard, as you know, there's a basket over there that has a couple of large Italian cookies. They are the exact ones that were displayed in a bakery window in Rome at Easter time in probably 50 years ago. And he bought them there, and he brought them home, and he kept them all these years. They are a primitive Italian symbol of fertility to make crops grow more plentifully each spring. That was always his story, and he always stuck to it. And question number two, was he really that funny all the time? And of course the answer is, yeah, pretty much. He couldn't help himself. He was one of the most good-natured humans I ever knew, and he made me laugh every single day, usually more than once, more often than you can really imagine. And of course, as you also can imagine, it's the thing I absolutely miss the most. We love you all. Thank you for joining us and for the support and help that you've given to our family. We are so happy to have you here to celebrate Ron's life with us. Thank you.
Dad often said that he felt like one of the luckiest people in the world. And in many ways, he was. He led the life that he'd envisioned for himself, shaped by a distinctly personal set of values and aspirations. I think, though, that very little of that had to do with luck. He created his life like he created his art, with great precision and care. He just made it look whimsical and easy. Most people think of Dad as a sweet, zany artist whose head was up in the clouds of Mukfa somewhere, and he definitely was that. But there was another side of him that many people didn't see, the serious, disciplined man whose feet were firmly planted on the ground. I did, and I was the beneficiary of his steadfast presence in my life, and what he taught me about life and love and work. Dad was fortunate enough to find his passion for art early in life, and through a combination of diligence, obstinance, and desire, he converted his talent into a successful career as a college professor and an acclaimed professional artist. Hardworking and prolific, he challenged himself continuously to explore different mediums and subjects in his work. He was passionate and he was focused. Although his art appears crazy and haphazard, trust me, every single whirligig and three-breasted mermaid was considered and planned. He was remarkably serious about creating all that silliness. From Dad's example, I learned the importance of commitment and self-discipline and a finely honed work ethic. In our house, you worked during the day and you played at night. Everyone was entitled to have fun, but only after they'd earned it. And we had lots of fun in our lives. Dad had a zest that was infectious. Early on, he introduced me to his love for the Marx Brothers and Charlie Chaplin, Broadway musicals, classical music and ballet, Monty Python and the Beatles. We spent a lot of time together, more than most fathers and daughters of my generation, in his studio after school, and with Mom during long summers on Little Deer Isle and traipsing around Europe on sabbatical years. We were an adventurous trio who explored life and the world together. Everything was in bounds and in balance. One of Dad's favorite sayings, which I repeat often to my daughters, is, "Everything is okay in moderation." Now, neither artists nor university professors earn much money, and we didn't have a lot of it when I was growing up. This compounded Dad's intrinsic concern about finances. A depression baby who grew up feeling that there was never enough money, he often joked that his family was too poor to give him a middle name. We watched money carefully in our household, and Dad taught me some important lessons about economy. For instance, what other people mistakenly consider to be single-use items, like tea bags and Kleenex, can actually be used multiple times throughout the course of a day or even days. Those in the audience who are laughing know what I'm talking about. Lights were always turned off when we left a room, and we never, ever ordered from the top of the menu. But somehow, there was always enough money to pay for the important things. Books, live performances, trips to foreign countries, and always education. Nowhere were his values and priorities more evident than in his personal relationships. Dad was a gregarious introvert. He loved chatting and joking with people, but did not seek them out. Mainly, he was delighted to be surrounded by his inner circle of family and friends, many of whom are here today. Dad found two incredible life partners to whom he was devoted and who he delighted in every day. My mother, an Ohio farm girl, who was different from him in almost every way except in a shared desire to forge a new life together. And Barbara Cabot, who gave him a second chance at love and is a cherished addition to our family. Every day of my life, I was secure in the knowledge that Dad loved and was incredibly proud of me. And he felt the same way about Josh and his granddaughters. In what turned out to be our last conversation, 5 days before he died, Dad told me how grateful he was to have three extraordinary granddaughters and how much he cherished them. The love that we felt from him every day was his most profound lesson of all. Although Dad was neither a religious man nor an activist, he had very clear principles, artistic, political, moral. And in his gentle way, he was uncompromising about those. I think it's safe to say that Dad spent nearly every day of his life doing the work he loved and surrounded by the people he adored. I can't imagine a better definition of a life well lived. There's a line in one of Dad's beloved musicals, Pippin, that says, "It's smarter to be lucky than it's lucky to be smart." But I think Dad was both.